So we've discussed what single nucleotide variants are, and we've discussed that they can have genetic impacts, such as various diseases. But how do we actually find these rare variants that occur in the population? So we're going to take a sequencing approach to this, where we're going to take multiple copies of the same genome, we're going to randomly fragment it into little tiny pieces, and we're going to sequence each of these tiny pieces into these small chunks called read pairs, where a single fragment of known length has both of its ends sequenced. So we know the sequences of both of its ends. Then each of these reads, we can then map to the reference genome and then see what differences do each of our reads have with respect to the reference genome. So in this example, the reference genome is shown in blue, and each of the black sequences is one of our reads. And you'll notice certain positions of the reference genome, every single read that maps to that position has a variation with respect to the reference genome. So for example, we see a line of T's where every single read that mapped to that position had a T, where the reference genome had a C. This tells us that this individual probably has a T in this position, and this T would be marked as a single nucleotide variant. The more reads that we have, the better signal we can get. So this was whole genome sequencing, where basically we sequenced the entire genome and tried to find all of the possible variants that are all throughout the genome. But it turns out that a lot of interesting variants, such as the one in cystic fibrosis, occur in protein-coding regions. So if we somehow knew beforehand that we're specifically looking for a variant that affects a protein, specifically the sequence of a protein, then we can only sequence the exome instead, which only consists of 2% of the length of the whole genome, and we'd be able to sequence at a much deeper coverage for the exact same price. So exome sequencing, basically, we can get more reads at the same cost as genome sequencing because we're only looking at these very targeted positions in the genome. However, by definition, exome sequencing gives us absolutely no information of anything outside of the exome. Basically, we have to have probes that are known beforehand to target this exon, this exon, this exon, and the only information that we can get is the region directly next to that probe. So in some patients, cystic fibrosis doesn't present itself as a lung disease. Specifically, there's a disease called congenital bilateral absence of the vas deferens, in which the individual is missing both vas deferens, so semen doesn't contain sperm, and this is actually a type of CFTR. And then later, these individuals can also develop a lung disease, but it's not guaranteed. So in the original cystic fibrosis that we discussed, it was a single mutation within the protein coding region of the CFTR gene, but in this special type of cystic fibrosis, it's actually caused by an insertion within an intron of CFTR. So if we knew that we were looking for cystic fibrosis, we still wouldn't necessarily be able to rule out whole genome sequencing because this type of cystic fibrosis would not be able to be detected with exome sequencing. So this is typically the trade-off that we see. With whole genome sequencing, we can see a wider spread of the genome, but it costs more because there's so much of it. Whereas with exome sequencing, we can do a lot deeper sequencing for relatively cheaper because we're only sequencing 2% of the genome. But the problem is we're only sequencing 2% of the genome. We're missing so much that isn't seen that may have functional effects on gene expression or other facts of the protein expression.